But now to the president's meeting today with Israel's prime minister at the White House and what it means for the U.S. role in Israeli-Palestinian relationship. Hari Sreenivasan has that.
I'm looking at two-state and one-state, and I like the one that both parties like.
With that, President Trump served notice that he is not wedded to long-standing U.S. support for a two-state solution to resolve the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. He spoke with Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu at his side.
I thought for a while the two-state looked like it may be the easier of the two. But honestly, if Israel and the Palestinians are happy, I'm happy with the one they like the best.
The president urged a wider peace pact as well, involving other Middle Eastern countries.
And it is something that is very different, hasn't been discussed before. And it's actually a much bigger deal, a much more important deal in a sense.
Mr. Trump also left open the possibility of moving the U.S. embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, despite Palestinian demands that East Jerusalem be their capital. Netanyahu called for the U.S. and Israel to seize this moment, and he laid out his conditions for peace.
First, the Palestinians must recognize the Jewish state. They have to stop calling for Israel's destruction. Second, in any peace agreement, Israel must retain the overriding security control over the entire area west of the Jordan River.
The Palestinians vehemently oppose that second element. They also flatly reject Israel's ramped-up construction in Jewish settlements in the West Bank. That point elicited this exchange today.
I'd like to see you hold back on settlements for a little bit. We'll work something out, but I would like to see a deal be made. I think a deal will be made. So let's see what we do.
Let's try it.
Doesn't sound too optimistic, but that's okay. He's a good negotiator.
Netanyahu later added,
I believe that the issue of the settlements is not the core of the conflict, nor does it really drive the conflict. I think it's an issue. It has to be resolved in the context of peace negotiations. We also are going to speak about it.
As the two leaders talked at the White House, Palestinian officials say President Mahmoud Abbas met secretly Tuesday with CIA Chief Mike Pompeo in the West Bank city of Ramallah.
Joining me to delve further into the news out of today's White House news conference and where the Israeli-Palestinian issue stands at the beginning of the Trump administration are Shibley Telhami. He's the Anwar Sadat Professor for Peace and Development at the University of Maryland. And Tamara Kaufman Wittes. She's a senior fellow in the Middle East Policy Center at the Brookings Institution, and she served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Near Eastern Affairs in the Obama administration from November of 2009 to January of 2012. Shibley, I want to start with you. What did both of these leaders get out of this before they even began to have conversations?
First, domestically, you know, Mr. Netanyahu is obviously looking back home. He's in trouble in an investigation on corruption. He's being pressured from the ultra-right. So he wants to show, at a time when Israelis are uncertain about where the president is going to go, where President Trump is going to go, he wants to show that he can make a deal with the president, that he can have a working relationship with him, that he can deliver. It helps him at home. With Mr. Trump, Mr. Netanyahu is very popular in the Republican Party. In my polls, actually, he's up there with Ronald Reagan as one of the most popular leaders in the world, and especially among the evangelical right. So just by virtue of looking like the cordial and the photo op, they both score points at home. Obviously, they also score points on some issues that we knew they would score points on. For example, the stated American support for Israeli security, the fight on terrorism, the Iran issue. Those are issues where there isn't much difference, at least rhetorically, and those obviously are the ones that register. But then, of course, we turn to the more central question where there will be inevitably some disagreements, the Israeli-Palestinian question.
Yeah, that's right. Tamara Wittes, I want to get to you with that. The one-state, two-state statement by the president today. The U.S. has always been committed to a peaceful resolution to this, but why is the president's announcement today so important?
Well, look, I think it's always been the American position enunciated previously by U.S. presidents that we can't want peace more than the parties themselves and that the parties have to agree to a solution of their conflict and we will support them in doing that. What's changed here is that for a long time, under President George W. Bush and then under President Obama, the U.S. has agreed with both parties that a two-state solution, that is independent sovereign states for Israel and for Palestine, is the only stable, lasting solution for peace in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. Today, Donald Trump suggested that there might be some other outcome that could deliver a lasting peace, and that does throw into question the objective of any negotiation.
If I may add on this one, in terms of what is missing here, what is missing is when the statement is it's up to the parties to negotiate with no reference to international law or previous agreements or some framework. You're leaving it up to the Israelis and Palestinians. It's a very unequal relationship. They're not going to be able to do this on their own without reference to what has been agreed or some grounds rule. That's number one. Number two, the president throws in there the one state. He only gives two alternatives, two states, one state. Well, if you have one state, it can be only one of two ways. Not a Jewish state, a democratic state for Arabs and Jews, but not a Jewish state, or an apartheid state. By the way, if Obama had put that proposal on the table, just like Trump stated it, he would have been attacked from all over the place from the right by suggesting the one-state solution could be on the table. So this one is really interesting because you've got some agreements both on the left and right about the impossibility of a two-state, but what they mm-hmm. want is something completely different.
Shibley Telhami, just staying with you for a second, is a one-state solution a non-starter for the Palestinians?
No, it's not a non-starter, even though I think for many of them, obviously they don't see it as realistic. When you ask them, do you think it's going to happen, most say no. But if they think that if they can have a full, equal relationship within Israel, well, of course they would, because ultimately there'll be a majority. That's not a non-starter, but it's a non-starter if they're not going to have equal relations. But it is a non-starter for Israelis, undoubtedly.
Tamara, Wittes, both men said that the goal might be more achievable if more regional partners got involved. What are the possible repercussions if there are more people at the table?
Well, look, I think this is an idea that's actually been tossed around for a while. It's something that President Bush and Secretary Condoleezza Rice tried to do at their Annapolis conference, bring together the region as a whole, partly to compensate for Palestinian weakness and to put more on the table that's attractive to Israel in terms of regional security and stability and regional cooperation. So in principle, expanding the pie actually does give you more options for resolving the conflict. Mm-hmm. In practice, however, the Arab states have made clear over and over again that they are not going to get in front of the Palestinians in solving this conflict. They're going to go where the Palestinians are willing to go and not beyond. I still don't see any reason to think that that's changed. And so I think this sort of outside-in approach will last only as long as the Arab governments think that the Palestinians want it to last.
Shibley Telhami, is there, you know, Prime Minister Netanyahu started saying today that basically there are lots of things that he has in common with Arab states. Say, for example, their fear of a more powerful Iran. Would all of these Arab states, in that shared fear or concern with Israel, would they put the Palestinian state on the back burner?
First, he's right that there are a lot of common interests, and that shows. And obviously, you know, the president of Egypt, the king of Jordan, the leader of the UAE, they have some cooperative relationships strategically, whether it's on Iran or fighting terrorism. And also, they all have working relations with Trump and even with Putin as the president of Russia. So in some ways, you have this kind of strategic picture. But the big elephant in the room is the Israel-Palestine question. It always has been. As Tamara said, you can put, you know, if it weren't for that, of course, then you can have it. Now, what Netanyahu wants to do is to show to the Israeli public that he can build settlements and not really make the concessions that are needed on the Palestinian issue and still make peace with the Arab states. And he wants Trump to help him. Now, one of that's the way the Arabs have mm-hmm. interpreted historically. Well, interestingly, in the news conference today, look at the body language. Netanyahu was the one to say, this is essentially my plan that I taught Trump to advocate, instead of letting it even look like a Trump plan, because his interest is ultimately to send a message at home that he's the one who's making Trump do it, rather than to have the Arabs have a fig leaf to come on board. I think many of them might play with Trump. They don't want to say no to him. They have their own selfish interests to want to play. The Saudis remain a big question, but ultimately, I think, when push comes to shove, the Palestinian issue may be just a fig leaf for something other than Israeli-Palestinian peace.
All right, Shibley Telhami. I'm sorry, Tamara, what is it? Very quickly, if you want to wrap up.
Sure. Just to add, I think that what's really bringing Israel and the Arab states together right now is a common sense of threat. It's not necessarily a common vision for the region's future.
All right. Tamara Wittes, Shibley Telhami, thank you both.
Thank you.